It's not a dream. God will make all things new that day. Gone is the curse from which I stumbled and fell. Evil is banished to eternity. Never crying again, and praises to the great I am. We will live in the light of the risen Lamb.
never let me go. I lay it all down again, oh Lord, to hear you say that I'm your friend. You are my desire, no one else will do. Cause nothing else can take your place. Oh no, no, to feel the warmth of your embrace. Help me find a way, bring me back to you.
Never let me go.
Never let me go.
Before you go home, sing it softly to the Lord. You're all I want.
Yes, you are. You're all I've ever, all I've ever needed. You're all I want. Help me know you near. Help me know you. Don't you ever leave me. Help me know you.
Jesus said, I am resurrection and I am life. He who believes in me, though he dies, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases, and his compassion never fails. Every morning they are renewed. Jesus said, Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. If we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. We brought nothing into the world, and we can take nothing out. The Lord gives, and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. The eternal God is our refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, have mercy upon us. In faith, we receive the body of our sister, Shirley Delores, for burial. Our sister was washed in holy baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Let us therefore with confidence pray to God our Heavenly Father, the giver of life, that he will raise her to perfection in the company of the saints. O God of grace and glory, we remember before you this day our sister Shirley Delores. We thank you for giving her to us, her family and friends, to know and love as a companion on our earthly pilgrimage. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see in death the gate of eternal life, so that in quiet confidence we may continue our course on earth until by your call we are reunited with those who have gone before, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Rest eternal grant unto her, O Lord. The hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Thank you. You may be seated. Paul wrote in 1 Thessalonians 13-14, "But I would not have you be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not even as others which have no hope. For we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them which sleep in Jesus God will bring with him." Well, Miss Squires, surely some of you know them, know her. She did that. So we mourn now as others. We mourn because we lost her physically, but we didn't lose her spiritually. So there's nothing more wrong with mourning and weeping, but we have hope. Dear Father God, thank you for this life that you've given us. We ask that you bless Ms. Squires' husband, Mr. Squires, Marcellus. Ask you to strengthen him, dear Lord, as he goes through this time of mourning. We ask you to give him comfort, give him peace, and we also ask you, Lord, to give him joy. When he thinks about the times they spent together. Dear Father God, also, Father God, we ask you to bless the four children that she had, her four daughters, Sharon, Denise, Carol, and Trudy, the four little girls that she gave birth to. Ask you to give them strength, comfort, time when they need strength. And Father God, I ask you to give them a spirit of unity, Lord, so that they can lean on each other in their time of need. We ask you to bless the grandchildren, the great-grandchildren, nieces, nephews, uncles. Bless her sister, Lord. Bless her sister, the last one left. Bless her in a mighty way. Give her joy and comfort and encouragement also, Lord. Bless in-laws. Bless everyone. And the family, even names or titles I didn't cover, but cover everyone. And dear Father God, Ms. Scars was an extraordinary person you put on this earth. I ask you to bless the friends and family that have touched this family, that have touched Mr. Squires, that have helped him, that have encouraged the daughters. And Father God, I ask you to give us strength, Father God, as friends, acquaintances, co-workers, or anyone that just knows her and has been touched by her, Father God, lift our arms, Lord, as we lift theirs, to help strengthen their daughters and the husband. Dear Father God, we thank you for this life. She was an extraordinary woman, and we thank you. We thank you for this life that she's given us, and she was truly an extraordinary person, and we give you glory and honor for her life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And I now invite Ron McElroy to lead us in a special song, Ave Maria, which will be followed by the eulogy, which will be read by Sean Agarton. Ron McElroy.
Ave Maria, gratia plena, Maria gratia plena, Maria gratia plena, Ave, Ave Dominus, Dominus tecum, benedicta tu in mulieribus, et benedictus, et benedictus fructus ventris. Ventris to Jesus. Ave Maria.
Shirley was born to Carlton and Doris Holder in St. John, Barbados. As a child, she attended Belmont Primary School and the Modern High School. She went on to teach at the Abbey School in the 1950s. Shirley married the love of her life, Marcellus Squires, from Bank Hall in St. Cyprian's Church in 1963. In 1968, the family immigrated to the USA. Shirley worked as an accountant at Bell Telephone Company while continuing her education at New York University. This helped her to launch her accounting career at ABC Television Studios in New York City. Later, the family moved to Atlanta, Georgia, where Shirley worked 20 plus years at CNN, Cable News Network. In Atlanta, Shirley was the center of community life. She was one of the founding members of the Atlanta Barbados Association. She was instrumental in starting the Atlanta Peach Caribbean Carnival and other cultural events in the city. Shirley and Marsh hosted celebrities, dignitaries, Olympic athletes. She welcomed all types of people to her home and her dinner table. She also hosted Prime Minister Sandiford, Bishop Gomez, the Barbados Central Cricket Club, the Atlanta Barbados Police Exchange, and former Mayor Andrew Young, just to name a few. Shirley even served as a 1996 Olympic house mother to the Seychelles athletic team. Shirley was so active in her community that the mayor, late Maynard Jackson, presented her with a key to the city, recognized her as one of Atlanta's most influential citizens. There was always room in her heart and at her table as she worked on several philanthropic events, such as feeding the homeless and working with the Barbados Association to provide scholarships for Barbadian youth and in Atlanta, and building houses with the President Jimmy Carter's Habitat for Humanity. Her friends spanned the globe, and her impact crossed borders, cultures, and generations. Shirley was a consummate chef, and her cooking is legendary. Her pudding and sauce, rice and peas, and fish cakes will be missed by all. From Barbados to the US, Shirley represented the very best, and she made everybody feel at home, young and old. In addition to leaving a large extended family and hundreds of friends, Shirley is survived by her husband, Mars, her sister, Lucy Agard. She's also survived by her children, Denise, Sharon, Carol, her husband, Ralph, and Trudy, and her husband, Edric, and Brian. She leaves behind four grandchildren, Serena, Brittany, Anna, and Naya, who she was very proud of, and four great-grandchildren in Renee, Brianna, Karen, and Kamari. She's preceded in death by her brother Edsel, her two sisters Jean Holder and Merle Solane. Shirley's life cannot be captured in these few words. She will be remembered by the laughter and the memories of good times. Shirley embraced life fully through family, church, friends, volunteer work, and community. Our lives were made richer in knowing her.
Kindly remain seated for the first lesson to be read by Cheryl Holder.
A reading from the Word of God written in Ecclesiastes chapter 3, beginning to read at the first verse. For everything there is a season, and a time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pluck up what is planted, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to break down and a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to throw away stones and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to seek and a time to lose, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to sow, a time to keep silence and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. What gains has the worker have from their toil? I have seen the business that God has given to everyone to be busy with. He has made everything suitable for its time. Moreover, he has put a sense of past and future into their minds, yet they cannot find out what God has done from the beginning to the end. The word of the Lord.
The first time I saw her, as she paced the floor, I knew I adored her. As I watched more and more, her touch was so tender. She was happy in life, and I know I can tell, because I know her well. She is my darling wife. Yes, she is my
Yes, I'll always love her. She means the world to me. She's the reason our children grew up so nice. Now I wanna thank her for staying by my side. And it must be said, I've never regretted taking her as my bride. Like a magnet attached, her gaze swept over me, but it couldn't pass. I knew we were meant to be, always so great. We were blessed from above. She's my one and only. She's my darling and true. She's my wife, she's my love.
From the Holy Gospel according to John, chapter 14, beginning at verse 1. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I would go and prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to the Lord, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way, I am the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Peace I leave with you. Peace I give to you. I do not give gifts as the world gives. Do not let your heart be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. The word of the Lord.
Now I have a series of tributes, the first by Darcy King of Atlanta Barbados Association, to be followed by Clyde Griffith of the Barbados Beach family, and the children will give a tribute to Mom, Mr. Darcy King.
Shirley Squires was a remarkable woman who left an indelible impression on all who had the pleasure of knowing her. Her legacy is such that even people who did not know her personally were positively impacted by the inestimable joy that was spread by her warm-hearted spontaneity, her hospitality, and her generosity. This well-deserved tribute is written on behalf of a grieving Barbados diaspora in Atlanta, Georgia, in the United States, where Shirley spent most of her years. Over 30 years ago, Shirley and her family initiated informal gatherings at her home, which resulted in the birth of the Barbados Association of Atlanta. She facilitated a fellowship and spirit of solidarity that allowed our diaspora in Atlanta to feel at home away from home because of the welcoming atmosphere of the Squire's household. I'm told that there was always something there to eat and drink, and I can testify to that, which always reflected always the best of Barbados. Indeed, the folklore of the Barbados Association of Atlanta is full of references to the Shirley Squires model of community organization and the concept of working together for the common good. In recent years, we have missed her unique gifts as a genuine patriot and humanitarian. But hope springs eternal in the human breast, and so her great example will live on as a legacy. The Atlanta Bajan diaspora will never forget her contributions, and I trust that Shirley's untimely passing will inspire us all to seize the day and make hay while the sun shines. And this is from the current Honorary Consul. He said, "It is regrettable that I did not get to know Shirley as well as many of the Atlanta Caribbean diaspora members due to my relatively recent arrival in 2011. However, I knew her brother Edsel well, and in recent years I have developed a strong personal relationship with her daughter Sharon, as Dr. Sharon Squires, through numerous telephone conversations on diaspora matters. In these conversations, a clearer and clearer picture of Shirley began to manifest itself, and I realized that I had missed out on getting to know a truly remarkable lady." Now, for those of you who don't know, Dr. Sharon Squires carries on what her mother imbued in her. In Shakespeare's Julius Caesar, we are reminded that death, a necessary thing, will come when it will come. We must accept that our dear friend Shirley has completed her earthly service and has earned everlasting rest. As we celebrate the life of this outstanding Barbadian, a few lines from Thomas Gray's famous elegy come to mind and are paraphrased here. "Full many a flower is born to blush unseen and waste its sweetness on the desert ear." Not so with Shirley. The beauty of her incandescent bloom was there for all to see, and her light and warmth remains with us today and will remain with us for many years to come. The Barbadians and friends of Barbados in the Atlanta area have asked me, as the Honorary Consul for Barbados to Atlanta for many years, to extend our deepest condolences to Marsh and to the extended Squires family. We trust that the many pleasant memories of the joy that Shirley brought to so many lives will temper your grief and bring eventual solace. May her soul rest in peace in the everlasting arms of the Almighty. And I very quickly must tell you one other memento personally that I must share. Shirley, we started, Professor Cardinal Ward and I started a program to teach Barbadian and Caribbean youth STEM technologies. That was started really in Shirley's house, and her daughter, Dr. Sharon Squires, continues to assist with this program to this day. Now, Dr. Sharon Squires was the person who literally built the Barbados Association website in Atlanta. And you should know that that program that was started in Shirley's house, Marsh may not remember, it now has 10 Caribbean students in MIT. There are so many things that were started in that household that I could go on and on, but I think you guys understand the magnitude of the lady who is resting here in peace.
I must confess, this is one of the most, I've done many of these things, but this one is one of the most difficult I've ever had to do in my life. You know, by way of recognition, you know, we have a group called the Browns Beach Family. I don't know how many are here today, but there are a lot of us, at least 25 of them. And I know that the founders of this Browns Beach family, we used to call it the Browns Beach Posse. But we've had significant tragedy this year alone. One family suffered a loss of 4 people close to them. And we banded together. We said, no, we got to get together and be close to them. Then our founder, Dolly, lost her daughter, and we got together with her to provide our support. Indeed, what we would do is cancel events until after the burial in respect of those people. And one of our icons, Mark Norville, he said, listen, because of the closeness that we feel, we cannot call this a posse anymore. That's too trivial. Let's call it a family. And that's how we started. But some things have happened in that family. There was a time when the ladies cooked every Wednesday and brought the meals, delicious meals every Wednesday. And then one day somebody said, we have to get the men to cook every Wednesday, every third Wednesday. And the first thing that happened is that one of these men came, when he, what was his contribution? A grapefruit and a can of luncheon meat. So we've had those experiences, and we've asked Raul Chandler, my friend Raul Chandler, I don't know if he's here now. Oh, Stanley, let me see Raul, an organizer of class. And we asked Raul, Raul, why don't you organize the men and make sure that all of the men who are every Wednesday they have to cook, the men bring different dishes. And it worked out very well. But I found out on one occasion, I said, but I don't see anything from Marsh coming here. What's happening? Raul, do you talk to Marsh? He says, whenever I call to talk to Marsh, I talk to Shirley. So it dawned on me then that even though I didn't know if Marsh, up to now, I don't know if Marsh can cook. But I happen to know, I happen to feel that the food that we get from Shirley, when the women cook, tastes the same way when the men cook. So I drew my own conclusions. I drew my own conclusions, in effect, saying, you know something? I don't think Marsh is holding out on us. I don't think so. But we have suffered. Margaret, I know who's here. She's suffered, one of our icons. I call them all of them icons because we have a deep-seated respect and love for one another. It's not just about cooking. It's about getting together, sharing stories, sharing music, sharing laughter and love. And all the time you get there, you see Shirley sitting down very, very quietly. Very quietly. You know, the food is there. Everybody's eating. Strangers come. People come in the evenings and say, you know, can I have something to eat? We get them food. No big thing, you gotta feed them. And Shirley was always instrumental in bringing enough food. So I wanted to start this tribute on Shirley by looking at something written by a man called Stephen Covey, who wrote a book called The Seven High Habits of Effective People. Habit number 2 was begin with the end in mind. And I started saying, what does he mean by that? What he meant was that you need to program what you want to be said about you. Then your time comes to go where Shirley has gone. Does it happen? It happens sometimes. But it's a very cogent a way of looking at life. You should be able to know that what you've done in your life has so impacted people in every single way that you should be able, they should be able to say, this is what has happened. I have tried to work out ever since, I knew Shirley from at school. We went to the same high school. I knew that March knew her. I knew her before you, March, let me tell you that. Anyway, imagine this. I believe that Covey himself might have said, look, you know, there's somebody out there who's creating this example for me to follow. Begin, always remember that, begin with the end in mind. So that people don't get away and start talking a lot of foolishness about you when you can't respond at that particular time. You may be able to respond later, but at that time, you can't get them to respond. So it's better to make sure your life is so programmed that you have decided, okay, this is what they have to say about me. So we have to say good things about Shirley. I deliberately, when we decided that we're going to have this tribute, to ask questions of a number of people who are part of our beach family. And the answer was the same all the time. She's excellent, she's an icon, she's kind, always willing to feed you. And that's the hallmark of people who can cook well. I hope you understand that. If you can cook well, you like to see people eating. The Norvels know that. I eat a lot of food at their house. So I just wanted to say, look, how much more can we say about Shirley Delores Squires? How much more can we say? We've heard all the tributes, all the kind things. She was classy. She had no prejudices. She just sat and enjoyed watching people eat her food. That's the reality of it all. You know, she was caring, and as Dolly said to me, she was the glue that held us all together. To me, that was a telling tribute. She was the glue that held us all together. Marsh, we are all with you. We support you, you know, we've gathered around you. But I know that this is a great loss, 57 years and not 57 days. Now we're going to have to get a group to teach you how to cook. I thank you.
All week long, we've been here for a month. And all month long, I was practicing what I was going to say and how I was going to say stuff about mom putting on sauce and fish cakes and all of that kind of stuff. But I thought that I would say something different. On the back of the program, it says, there are some who bring a light so great to the world that even after they have gone, the light remains. And I want y'all to know that Mom is shining that light on all of you all. Mom represented celebrating life, celebrating people, celebrating family. And I encourage you to take what you have gotten from Mom and continue to do that. Continue to bake fish cakes and continue to have parties and continue to gather, because that is what she would want from all of you who are her family. And you know, Mom didn't spend a lot of time mourning. After this, she would be ready with a rum and coke and some ice and ready to sit down and listen to some music. And Mom would like you all to live and understand that this is hard, but she gave all of us the tools to survive her. She gave all of us the relationships to continue after she was gone. And so that is what I want you to leave you with. The light that was Shirley is now in every single person in this room. And remember that, and get phone numbers. Their family here that discovered their family just a couple minutes ago. Bring those families together and continue what she started. And thank you for embracing us. Thank you for coming to the house. Thank you for feeding us. And thank you for caring for us. And I know she would say thank you and she would appreciate it very much. And right. So.
I'd like to tell the other side. Mom has talents that did go down through the line. For example, Mom can argue. She can argue any point, anytime, anywhere. Thus, we have a lawyer. Brian got that gene, and it carries down. Mom has the hands that can cook, stir it in 5 minutes, and serve 50 people, and each one of them with a smile. With that, she gave us Trudy. Trudy will master the art behind the table. Mom had a thing for entertaining. She can set it up, line it up, and that gene went to Carol. Carol is the master behind the fixing, all of the things being put together. And then I was trying to figure out what I did. And I realized that Mom was very creative. She had a talent with her hands. Thankfully, I think I got a little part of that. So in the jewelry and the art, I see Mom and I put her there. And I want to share all of us those things with you. And every time we see you, we remember this is what Shirley was all about.
So let me clear something up first. Uncle Marsh can't cook. He made me toast before, so he can cook. What I would say is that Aunt Shirley raised me since I was the age of 7. She was pretty much my mother since that time. I'll say she wasn't easy, but she is the only person that ever directly told me to be a leader, don't be a follower. And she instilled that in me. And if it wasn't for her and Uncle Marsh, I would not be where I am today. And frankly, I don't think any of us would be here today. Thank you.
There's no house without a home. And there's no man who wanna be alone. There's no child without a dream. And there's no song without a meaning. That's how I know. There's no me without you. There's no me without you, 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 you. There's no life without a plan. Auntie Shirley, you had yourself a great man. There's no without no tears. And time can go by throughout the years. That's how I know. There's no me without you, 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 you. There's no me without you, you, you. Yeah, 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 yeah. Ooh, ooh, yeah. Ooh. Yeah. This how I know. This how I know. Yeah. This how I know. There's no me. There's no me without you, 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 you. There's no me without you. Ooh, yeah, yeah. Oh, oh. Ooh, yeah, 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 yeah. Ooh, ooh. There's no house without a home. Oh, no man wants to be alone. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Ooh.
Rest in peace, Auntie Shirley. Uncle Marsh just want to see you. Thank you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. I wish for us to reflect on some words from the 25th chapter of the Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 34th through to the 36th verses. Then the king shall say unto those at his right hand, Come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom that was prepared for you from the foundations of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you clothed me. I was in prison, and you visited me. I was sick, and you cared for me. I believe that just on hearing the recitation of these words, some of you would have had images in your mind of some interaction with our sister Shirley. For based on everything I've heard about her this afternoon, though I can't recall having met her in that way in life, you told a story of a person who embodied exactly what Jesus spelled out as the criteria by which we'll be judged ultimately, our interaction with our fellow human beings. And as I sat there reflecting on all that would have been said, a saying came to mind: those who live for themselves, their memories die and are buried with them. But those who live for others live on long beyond their time in this world. I believe our sister Shirley epitomized the latter. She lived for others. And this particular passage from St. Matthew's Gospel forms a part of a broader text which represents the culmination of our Lord's ministry, teaching ministry, according to that Gospel. And when one reads Matthew 25, it can be really parsed in three different stories. The first element is the first 13 verses, where we get the story of the 10 virgins, 5 being wise and 5 being foolish. And the message there is about the urgency of serving God in this life. For we know not when our time will come to an end. And so there must always be this preparation. There must always be this readiness. And so we hear our Lord's words in verse 13 of Matthew 25. Therefore, keep watch, for you do not know at what hour the Master will come. I believe that can be tied to what our brother, Clyde Griffith, said not long ago. Live life with the end in mind. Be constantly prepared. Or perhaps like what a Jewish rabbi said to his followers, make it a point to repent on the day before you die. And they said to him, but how will we know which day is the day before we die? He said, that's just it. Repent every day. Make sure that you're prepared, for ultimately there will be a judgment. But then the second portion of Matthew 25, verses 14 through to 30, speak to how we should go about this preparation. Not just simply sitting down, waiting in our rooms. Not just simply sitting down and offering our prayers and singing our hymns and watching our TBN or whatever we do during the day. But actively utilizing the talents that God has given to us. And so we get the story of the talents. That we are not to bury the gifts that God has given to us, but use them to glorify him in this world. And again, our sister Shirley epitomized that. Some of you can probably still, even as you're sitting here, taste some of that food on the beach, that marsh cooked. She used the very gifts and talents that God had given her. She did not bury them. She did not hide them. She did not count some persons outside the pale that they could not experience what she had. And so we're told that she opened her life. She gave her gifts freely to all who came. And that is what God will judge us on. How we used what he has given us. And then ultimately, we get the very criteria for judgment, the basis upon which we'll be judged in this world. It will not be by how lustily we sang when we went to church, or how much scripture we quoted, but by our active living out of the same. I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me drink. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. I was naked and you clothed me. I was in prison and you visited me. I was sick and you cared for me. It is about touching other human lives. I've often said that Christianity is very much like a contact sport. We cannot play basketball without touching another person. And the same thing is true for Christianity. We cannot truly live out our lives in service to God without touching the lives of our fellow human beings. And when we can go through this criteria for judgment in Matthew 25, 31 and following, and as we read it, we can see Shirley actively at work. Not simply in the temporal feeding of others, not simply in the temporal giving drink, because in Matthew's gospel, Jesus' teaching is really enveloped in chapters 5 and chapter 25. And chapter 5 is where we get the Beatitudes. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. Blessed are the peacemakers. So it goes beyond even the offering of the mere food in this temporal existence, but to a deeper ethereal existence, where we reach out to the spiritual needs and the emotional needs of others. So in our world today, as was in Shirley's life, she would have encountered many persons who were hungry and thirsty, not simply for food and water, but hungry and thirsty for justice, hungry and thirsty for righteousness, hungry and thirsty to be recognized as human, because let us not fool ourselves. At the time when our sister Shirley would have been carrying out her activities, it was the time of the civil rights movement as well. There was a time when persons like Shirley were considered less than. And she would have seen many atrocities committed against others. But she did not cower. She stood up to coalesce a community. She stood up to bring a community together. She stood up to validate her brothers and sisters, to let them know that they too are loved by God, and that we too are cherished by God. And I believe that the best tribute we can pay to Shirley's legacy is to ensure that that message and that passion continues. For one may think that we have long passed the civil rights movement, but I believe Atlanta and indeed the United States is probably in just as much danger now as it was then. Because who would have thought that in the 21st century, the rhetoric that we thought the world had long dispelled and expunged in the 1940s, who thought that it would have come to the fore again? Who thought that we would see persons leading torch-lit ceremonies through our streets shouting blood and soil? You know what blood and soil is? That was the slogan of the Nazi movement in the 21st century. So our sister Shirley's memory and her life's work must never die with her. For even as we gather here to lay to rest her mortal remains, there are still many out there hungering and thirsting for righteousness. There are still many out there who have been stripped naked by the ideologies and rhetoric of this world. The very things that Shirley stood up against. And if we're going to pay any tribute to her, we must continue this work and recognize that the journey is not over. And Shirley's memory must not go to the grave with her. And her life's work is not only there to be written on a piece of paper and put on a wall, but we must carry it within us. As her daughter said, carry that light in our heart. That light for justice and righteousness. That light that seeks to lift persons up in a world that seeks to tear them down. So this afternoon is as much about Shirley as it is about us. It's an opportunity for us to do the type of reflection and introspection necessary. To ask ourselves, if I were to go today, how would I fit in with Matthew 25? If I were to juxtapose my life now with Matthew 25, what would it look like? Am I one who feeds the hungry? Do I offer that glass of water, and not just physical, but the passion of justice and righteousness to those who are thirsty? Do I welcome the stranger? Or am I one that passes persons into different groups and determine that some are beyond the pale of God's grace and not worthy to be mingled with, not worthy of my company? Do we seek to clothe persons when the world strips them of their pride and their dignity? Or do we just watch by and say, well, that's their business, I won't get involved? Do we care for the imprisoned? Those who perhaps have been imprisoned by their past. Those whom others refuse to release from their past. Do we reach out to them as Shirley did and open our homes and open our hearts and share our talents so that they can feel that they're a part of us? Do we care for the sick? Not just those lying in hospital, but those who are suffering from those illnesses, those addictions, that self-loathing spirit that prevents them from rising up and recognizing their value. Do we reach out to them? I believe even in death, Shirley is challenging us to grasp life. For ultimately, our eternity will be based on this criteria in St. Matthew 25. How do we care for each other? Or do we care at all? And so those of us whose lives have been specially touched by her, those of us who have experienced her love and care and her compassion,
those of us who have been beneficiaries of her empathy, those of us who have been beneficiaries of her wisdom. Today we are being challenged to look at ourselves. For each one of us is being called to be a Shirley in our varied spheres of existence. Each one of us is being called to bring a community together. Each one of us is being called to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim release to the captives, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. That was our Lord's ministry, and that is what he expects from us. And ultimately, that is how we'll be judged. I know that the pain of this present time is such that these words may be heard, but it's difficult to internalize them right now. And that is natural and necessary. For one near and dear to us has been taken away. And many of us may be experiencing that duel between our faith and the senses. For the senses tells us that it's over. That one near and dear to us is gone. We'll never taste her hand again, as we say in Barbados. We will never hear her again. We'll never interact with her again. We'll never be able to get that wonderful image of her sitting with her rum and coke just enjoying the beauty of life. And that can cause the type of pain that we're experiencing. But faith is also there telling us that there's more to this life than meets the eye. That death does not write the final verse in our existence. Indeed, if we were celebrating a mass today, the preface for the commemoration of the dead when we are preparing to go into the Holy Eucharist says, "For to your faithful people, O Lord, life is only changed and not ended. And when our mortal body lies in death, there is prepared for us a dwelling place eternal in the heavens." Or perhaps as St. Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 50, "Remember, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. For this perishable body must give way to imperishability, and this mortal body must give way to immortality. And when that happens, then the saying will be fulfilled, 'Death is swallowed up in victory. O grave, where is your sting? O death, where is your victory?'" It's powerful words. Powerful words of hope. But it does not take away the pain that we're experiencing at this present time. And that pain and the mourning and the crying, do as much of it as you need to. For that is all a part of the healing process. For it is only when we have exhausted the whole panoply of human emotions that our faith will come to the fore and say, "But there is more beyond this. That this Jesus in whom we believe died and rose again and promised that all who believe in him will experience eternal life. And not just eternal life, but something far beyond anything we can fathom in this life. A place where death will be no more. Neither will there be pain or sorrow or crying anymore. For the former things would have passed away." But in order to experience that, we must first deal with the changes and chances of this life. We must first feed the hungry and the thirsty and care for the stranger and care for the sick and embrace the prisoners and cover the naked, even in this life of uncertainty and changes and chances. And it is having done that, that we'll experience the bliss of what is beyond it. To you, the family and friends of our beloved sister Shirley, you, the members of the various groups that she would have served with such distinction, I take this opportunity to extend sincere condolences to you. As I said before, grief, that is natural. But when the pain of the present time dissipates, look fondly upon the memories of our sister Shirley, and give thanks to Almighty God for placing so beautiful a soul amongst us, one from whom we've learned so much, one who have touched our lives in so profound a way. And as you remember those things, remember also to incorporate them into your own existences, so that Shirley will continue to live on through us, and lives will continue to be transformed, that persons will continue to experience the beauty of what it means to be human in this world, that persons will understand the value of their mere presence in this world, simply because we have torn down all barriers, as Shirley did, and saw the beauty of humanity in each person. We pray that Almighty God may grant unto her eternal rest, and let light perpetual shine upon her, and that her soul and the souls of all the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, may rest in peace, and at the last, rise to eternal glory. Amen.
Let us pray. Father of all, we pray to you for Shirley Delores and for all those whom we love but see no longer. Grant to them eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. And may she and all your faithful departed, through your tender mercy, rest in peace. Amen. We now have the rite of commendation, when we commend the soul of our sister to the care of Almighty God. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant Shirley Delores with your saints, where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing, but life everlasting. You only are immortal, the creator and maker of mankind, and we are mortal.
formed of the earth, and to earth shall we return. For so did you ordain when you created me, saying, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. All of us go down to the dust, yet even at the grave we make our song. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant with your saints, where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing, but life everlasting. Lord, have mercy upon us. Christ, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Have mercy upon her, O Lord, in that awful day, when thou shalt come to judge this earth with fire. Oh, what a calamity! Oh, what a dreadful day! When the heavens shall open, and the Lord of hosts shall come to judge this earth with fire. Rest eternal grant unto her, O Lord, and let light perpetual shine upon her. Rest eternal grant unto her, O Lord, and let light perpetual shine upon her. And may her soul and the souls of all the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. Pray. Remember, O Lord, this your servant Shirley Delores, who has gone before us with a sign of faith and now rests in the sleep of peace. Grant unto her and to all who rest in Christ refreshment, light, and peace through the same Christ our Lord. Amen. And now to God's gracious mercy and protection I commit you. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you this day and forevermore. Amen.
Christ is risen from the dead, trampling down death by death, and giving life to those in the tomb. The Son of Righteousness is gloriously risen, giving light to those who sat in darkness and in the shadow of death. The Lord will guide our feet into the way of peace, having taken away the sin of the world. Christ will open the kingdom of heaven to all who believe in his name, saying, Come, O blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom that was prepared for you. Shirley Delores, into paradise may the angels lead you. At your coming may the martyrs receive you and bring you to that holy city, Jerusalem. Amen.
Draw me close to you. Never let me go. Lay it all down again, oh, oh, to hear you say that I'm your friend. You are my desire. No one else will do. Cause nothing else can take your place. Oh no, no. To feel the warmth of your embrace. Help me find a way. Bring me back to you. Bring me back. Oh,
you know the words you sing along.
Jesus.
Draw me close to you.
Yeah.
You say,
draw me close to you.
Never let me go.
Never let me go.